So my latest musical deep dive has been getting into jazz fusion from Japan. The music's super corny but fun and virtuosic and hip, and it got me thinking about retrofuturism and nostalgia. Anyway, we'll talk about that at the end of the video. For now, let's listen to some jazz. Okay, so well before Japanese jazz fusion, there was just jazz in Japan. And it started around the 1920s and 30s, mostly through bands that were playing on ocean liners. Whoever said that cruise ships don't make a positive influence in the world? It's not all cringe, it's sometimes culture. The people who were into jazz in Japan were not the underprivileged and oppressed communities that we normally associate with that era, especially around the sort of New Orleans jazz scene. Rather, jazz fans in Japan were higher class. For one, they could afford record players, but they also wanted to be part of the worldwide cultural movement that was jazz music. Anyway, jazz expectedly really kicked off after the Second World War, during the years of US occupation in the country. US soldiers who wanted to hear music at dances that they recognized would ask the Japanese bands to play jazz songs. Now remember, this is still in the sort of the tail end of the swing era, where big band jazz was the popular music, maybe the only time that jazz has ever been the popular music of the day. Of course, this is only until bebop blows up on TikTok, which is definitely gonna happen. I trust the children. Anyway, through the 1950s and 60s, jazz has a pretty robust scene. If you ever wanna see a video on that, leave a comment in the description. And like this video while you're down there. In the meantime, let's jump ahead to the 1970s and 1980s. So, jazz fusion is a kind of annoying term because it refers to one thing and also many, many things. In North America, fusion normally refers to jazz rock, which was a style pioneered by Miles Davis, Larry Coryell, and John McLaughlin, among others, in the 1960s, late 60s, and 1970s. But then there's jazz funk. Herbie Hancock's music and the Headhunters album is very associated with this genre, of course. And then there were bands like Weather Report, which I would call more like world and pop jazz fusion rather than jazz rock. I mean, if you want to get really specific, besides really straight ahead stuff, most jazz has some element of fusion in it, especially in the last couple of decades. With regard to that 70s, 80s Japanese jazz fusion, I kind of see it as a combination of jazz alongside pop music in Japan at the time. The fusion bands seem to have taken particular cues from a genre known today as city pop. Now, this is a revisionist genre name that really was just a particular type of music that was kicking around at the time. It's lush and super synth poppy, and Tatsuro Yamashita was the pivotal composer and producer at this time. Here's a little bit of his music. Alongside his own music, Yamashita also collaborated with his wife, Maria Takeuchi, culminating in the single Plastic Love, which had this weird, meme-y kind of resurgence back in 2017. Now, how much of a direct line you can draw between city pop and Japanese jazz fusion kind of varies by song, and it varies by band. But here's a T-Square song that just reeks of it. There's also an interesting and kind of important relationship between jazz fusion in Japan and the early video game industry in the country. For example, Masahiro Ando, the guitarist and founding member of T-Square, composed music for several of the early Gran Turismo games. And infamously, Koji Kondo, the composer of most of the early Nintendo soundtracks, including Mario and The Legend of Zelda, was, let's say, heavily influenced by several jazz fusion bands at the time. Thomas Game Docs has a great video on this, so I will leave a link to that at the end of this video. Good one to watch after you're done here. Speaking of other videos, why not subscribe to the channel so you see my future videos? That'd be great. Yeah, tops. So if you are interested in checking out some of this music, here are three bands that are probably the sort of no-brainers to check out. First, there's Prism, and they, on their modern website, claim to be the very first fusion band in Japan. They were formed in 1975, opened for Eric Clapton in 1976, and then got recording in 1977. Anyway, here's a track off their first release from 1977. Next up, let's cover the two sort of core bands from this scene, T-Square and Cassiopeia. T-Square started as The Square in 1976 at Meiji University, and they've gone through a ton of different sort of lineups and incarnations ever since. Masahiro Ando was the founding and, you know, long-standing guitarist of the band, and he has just left after their most recent album was released, Fly Fly Fly. Now, I played some of their earlier music earlier in the video, so here's something new from them off that most recent album, Fly Fly Fly. Finally, there's Cassiopeia. They're the other stalwart band of this scene, and they were also the first band that introduced me to this particular sound. Like T-Square, they were formed in 1976 and have been going pretty consistently, although they took a couple of small hiatuses. Here's some music from their killer live album from 1982, Mint Jams. Now, the main point of this video was just to kind of get you excited about Japanese jazz fusion, and like I hope I've done that. But one of the things that I came across in researching this video was this idea of retrofuturism and manufactured nostalgia. If you've ever been to a Disneyland, then you'll know a lot about manufactured nostalgia. But there's a really interesting conversation about that idea, and specifically the genre city pop, which is that kind of synth-drenched pop music from the 70s and 80s that I mentioned earlier. I came across an article by Kat Jung on Pitchfork, and you should read the whole thing. The link is in the description. But the argument is basically that the city pop genre, along with synthwave and vaporwave before it, and of course Japanese jazz fusion too, well, a lot of its appeal comes from this imagined memory of a past that is excited about the future. That really aggressive aesthetic of 80s synth pop, that sort of sun-drenched California sound, gives an almost visceral reaction and invocation of this very particular style of retrofuturism. A retrofuturism of which a revisionist version of was very much captured within the sort of vaporwave and synthwave movements of the early 2000s and 2010s. Add to that the fact that 1980s Japan, as Zhang writes, represented a kind of futurist utopia. It was the years of its economic miracle with nothing but relentless positivity for tomorrow. Here's my favorite quote from the article that I think explains this idea the best. The emotional response to city pop centers on these twin imaginations of Japan and the United States, the 80s and now, the prior promises of capitalism and its current reality. Online, listeners dwell on artificial memories of boom-era Tokyo, but also idyllic childhoods watching cartoons, reaffirming the claim that nostalgia appears to be longing for a place, but is actually a yearning for a different time. I mentioned that part of the appeal of Japanese jazz fusion are the strong melodies, interesting harmony, and kind of cheesiness that comes through, and that gives you immediately both that aesthetic, but also that kind of sense of wonder. And I guess when it's more critically viewed like this, I got a little embarrassed for liking it, for lack of a better term. There's a kind of political or class element to this because everything is about class. The current reality of capitalism for my generation and the one immediately after it is that we have not been treated as well as our parents were. And so I kind of understand why people like myself might be attracted to this kind of retro aesthetic. It's not just about escape. It's also about recapturing not only what was, but what might have been. Anyway, I just really wanted to make a video introducing people to Japanese jazz fusion and it became about class again. It's not the first time that this has happened. If you enjoyed this video, please like it and subscribe. That would be super rad. Here, somewhere near my head, it will be the link to the Thomas Games doc video about Koji Kondo. It's worth a watch. Until next time, I'll catch you later. Bye.